Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Today we will talk. We will continue our storytelling on model predictive control. And as we have seen in the previous lecture, model predictive control is an advanced control methodology where we use optimization to deduce the best possible control command. And we have seen that in order to implement model predictive control in a closed loop, what we need to do is to perform the optimization at each sampling instant, which means that we have only a limited amount of time at disposal to perform this optimization. Therefore, the optimization problem has to be as simple as possible. And we have seen a class of optimization problems which satisfy this criteria. We have seen that the so-called convex optimization problems are relatively easy to solve, and these kind of optimization problems are characterized by convexity of the objective function. And at the end of the previous lecture, we have seen what a convex function is, what is the formal definition of a convex function. And we have seen a mathematical proof which confirms that a square function indeed is a convex function. So now you should be able to prove convexity of at least simple functions. So at the final exam, I will give you another example and I will ask you to prove that a function is convex. You can try on your own to prove that a linear function is convex. Okay? So that's the simplest possible function you can think of. It's just ax plus b. And how would you convince me that such a function is convex? Because linear functions are both convex and concave. But we have also seen that convexity of the objective function is only one part of the overall problem. We also, for an optimization problem to be convex, also the constraints have to be a convex set. So that would be our next topic. But before, I would like to illustrate why it is so important or so useful to have a convex objective function. Because we said at the end of the previous lecture that a very nice feature of convex functions is that if we are able to find one optimum, then this optimum is the global optimum. While if the function would not be convex, like this function here, well, first of all, why this function is not convex? How would you explain that? And of course, you can explain it in mathematical terms, or you can try to explain it in simpler terms. So how would you explain to a friend of yours why this function is not convex? How would you approach this explanation? Nella, try it. Don't be afraid. Simple explanation. When is a function convex? So, maybe here. How would you interpret this figure? Why are we saying that this function is convex?
When we connect to points.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Of the line.
Okay, so we have these two points here. We have the point x and we have the point y. And this is the function value at point y. This is the function value at point x. And this is the line connecting these function values. So what does the condition then mean?
When we choose some point under the line.
Okay, so you mean a point on this curve here, and the curve is formally called the graph of the function. So we have a point on the graph, so what has to hold for this point? That it has to be where compared to this point? it should be beneath this line. And then we can extend it to an infinite amount of points, meaning the graph of the function on this interval has to lie below the line connecting these two points. Okay? Now apply the same reasoning to this function. And remember, if you are able to find two points such that if you connect them by a line, you have a graph which lies above the line, the function is not convex. Okay? So just pick, for instance, this point here, or okay, this one, and here. Okay? So we connect these two here. Does the graph lie below the line or not? It does not. It lives above the line, so that's why the function is not convex. Okay? And here we see what is the problem of convex functions. Of non-convex functions. Non-convex functions can have many optima, and some of them can be local and some of them can be global. And the problem of formulating and solving non-convex optimization problems is that it's essentially a casino. You don't know in which optimum you will end up. And of course, in control, we are always looking for the best possible control actions, for the best possible performance. Therefore, if the optimization would give us this point, and remember, we are always trying to minimize the cost function, because minimizing the cost function really means how much money you can save on your control performance. Meaning, if your numerical optimization procedure ends up here and somebody can find this optimum, it means that he is better than you are. Okay? While if the problem is convex, it is sufficient to find just one optimum, and you know it is the global, the best possible point on the graph of the function. Okay? So that's the danger of using non-convex functions, because you can have this kind of multiple local optima, and you are never really sure in which optimum you will end up. Now, there are of course methods in this kind of non-convex optimization which helps you to really find the global optimum, but that's why non-convex optimization takes much more time to find the global optimum compared to the convex optimization setup. And remember, in control in general, we are always restricted by time and by computational resources. That's why we are always aiming at convex problems, because they are easy to solve and you can always find the best point on the graph of the function. Okay? So, what are the typical examples of convex functions? The ones which are used most in practice are so-called norms. It can be shown that each norm is by definition a convex function. A norm is essentially a function which indicates a distance between two points. So if I am one point and the camera is on another point, a norm tells me what is the distance between these two points. To make it more complicated, there are different notions of a distance. What we consider a distance is the so-called Euclidean norm. Euclidean norm is the shortest path in it extends to arbitrary dimensions, but essentially now I'm in a three-dimensional space. Okay? So the true distance between myself and the camera would be the Euclidean norm. Euclidean norm formally is defined as the square root from the sum of squares of components of a vector x. So, whenever we are talking about norms and functions in general, they can take arguments which are multidimensional vectors. Okay? Also, my position in this room, it has an x coordinate, it has a y coordinate, and it has a z coordinate. Okay? So, position of my head is a composition of three scalars, the x-coordinate, y-coordinate, and the z-coordinate. Okay? And we will aggregate all these coordinates into one vector, and we will call the vector x. Okay? And the vector x, in my case, would have three components. And then if I have another vector, say vector y, which characterizes the position of the camera in this room, then I can say what is the distance between these two vectors. Okay? That's what a norm does. It tells you what is the distance of two points in an arbitrary space. And you know this formula quite well. Okay? Just apply it to a two-dimensional case. And just imagine you have a triangle. Okay? You have a triangle where this is the right angle. Okay? You have one point here, one point there. This is the distance which you are interested in, right? So this is distance, we will call it, for instance, C. The length of this line is A. This line segment has length of B. What is the length C, which is the shortest distance between these two points? How do you calculate it? We know a formula for C, right? What is C? C is what? It's the square root of A squared plus B squared. Okay? And now just say that I will put A and B into a vector X. Okay? Such that X1 is A and the second component is B. Okay? And then we can say that the two norm or the Euclidean norm is defined by this formula. Okay? And you find out that it's essentially the same because it's square root of x1 squared plus x2 squared, and now just substitute for x1, put there a, and for x2 we will put b. And we see that the result is the same. Okay? So the Euclidean norm really measures the traditional distance between two points. Okay? However, sometimes it makes sense to focus on or to measure distances not in the Euclidean sense, but in some other sense. And then I will return to these formal definitions, but essentially this is what a Euclidean norm of a vector X means. We have a vector. Each vector indicates a position of a point in the space. Essentially, you can imagine this as a difference between X and a zero vector. The zero vector is always the origin of the coordinate system. So essentially, this expression tells me how far away point X is from the origin. And we know how to recover this formula. But this is not the only notion of a distance of a point from an origin. There is, for instance, the so-called one norm, which is sometimes also called the Manhattan norm. Because if you imagine the map of Manhattan, then you would see that all streets are essentially perpendicular. Okay, so the map essentially looks like this. There are horizontal streets and then there are vertical streets. A Manhattan norm essentially means that if I am here and I want to get there, what is the distance I need to travel in Manhattan? Of course, the shortest distance would be this, right? But I'm traveling on foot, so I cannot fly. So essentially, the distance I have to travel is this part plus this part here. And that's the Manhattan norm, or in more mathematical terms, the one norm. Essentially, it is the sum of absolute values of individual coordinates. In other words, a one norm of a vector X is given as the sum of absolute values of individual coordinates. Now, why do we consider an absolute value here and not just pure X1, XI? Well, just imagine that the origin is here, okay? So this would be the point with coordinate 0, 0, okay? And I'm here at point, for instance, minus 1, minus 2. If I would consider just the sum of this guy and this guy, it would be minus 3, right? What kind of a distance is minus 3? Okay? A distance is always non-negative. That's why we always have to consider absolute values. Okay? Result, or each norm, better to say, X an arbitrary norm, P, is always non-negative. So it's always equal to or bigger than zero. You cannot have a negative distance between two points. Okay? So that's why we have to consider absolute values here. Here, we actually don't have to consider absolute values because we have a square which ensures that the number is always non-negative. Okay? So that would be the one norm or the Manhattan norm. And there is one more frequently used type of norms, and it's so-called infinity norm. Infinity norm formally is defined as the maximal component of the vector in absolute value. In other words, I have this point and say this point has coordinates 1, 4. What is the maximum from these two numbers? It's 4, right? So the infinite number, the infinity norm of a vector composed of 1 and 4 would be 4. Okay? What would be the infinity norm of this vector here? It would be 2. So remember, you first always take absolute values, and then you take the maximum element of the vector. Okay? Now we can go back. So typically we use either a 2 norm, 1 norm, or infinity norm. But essentially, for each integer p, there exists a norm. So you can as well have a 3 norm. A 3 norm would be the cubic root of a sum of components to p. So p, in our case, would be the integer 3. So we have the sum of cubes of elements of the vector, and then we take the third root of the sum. And actually, if you plug into this formula 1, what would happen? What do you get? So just imagine p is equal to 1. Do you get this formula? Or do you get this one? This one, right? Okay, so here we have 1, so nothing happens. We have 2 power of 1, nothing happens. So it's really just a sum of absolute values. Okay? If you plug in 2, you recover exactly this formula. Okay? Then you might wonder, like, what happened to the absolute values? Why don't we have absolute values here? Okay? But we know that the square root of an absolute value is the same as the square root of xi. Okay? So that's why we don't need the absolute values here. And actually, if you were to take the limit of this expression when p goes to infinity, you would find this expression. Norms other than a 2 norm, 1 norm, or infinity norms are almost never used in practice. They simply don't have any practical meaning. This one is used the most because it's the natural distance between two points. These two, as we will see later, have some advantages since they allow the optimization problem to become simpler compared to an optimization problem which uses two norms. All other type of norms would lead to very difficult optimization problems, or at least to problems which are more difficult compared to using these two norms. Okay? So as I said, norms are always indicator of a distance of two points. In the first case, you might wonder, I'm only showing one point. But then we always assume that in such a case we are interested in a distance of this point from the origin. So the origin always has the zero coordinate. We can extend this case to really trying to find out what is the distance between two points where both of them are different from the origin. In such a case, we are interested in a distance. So we put the two pipes. Two pipes always indicate that it would be a norm. A norm always means a distance. We are interested in a distance of a point x from a point y, so we have two points. And then this integer here, or sometimes it can even be the infinity sign, indicates the type of a norm we are interested in. Okay? And yet again, Euclidean norm, it's the shortest distance between these two. One norm is the Manhattan norm when you are restricted in moving in essentially along the axis. Okay? And infinity norm is the larger of these two coordinates. Better to say of the differences between these two coordinates. Okay? Now, these norms have direct relation to modal periodic control and this control in general. What are we trying to achieve in control? We want to find control input such that the system does something what we require. And this does something what we require is usually equivalent to saying, I want to deliver control input such that the output of the system follows certain reference. Following of a reference essentially means that you want to minimize the difference between the actual output and the reference. And you have somehow to quantify how big is the difference between the output and the reference. And that's exactly what a norm tells you. It tells you how far away you are from your reference. And you cannot be closer than zero distance, okay? Because the distance will be zero if and only if these two points are the same. Okay? And that's, we will see it later, that's what we do in modal periodic control. We say, please give me control inputs which minimize the difference between the output and the reference. And ideally, this difference, the control error, would be driven to zero. But that's why, the importance of norms is that they quantify this distance. You can quantify the distance as you wish. But if you use norms, you will get convex objective function, which is very important to have. Okay? But as I said, convexity of the objective function is only one part of the whole story. For an optimization problem to be convex, you also need the constraints to be convex sets. And for a convex set, we have a fairly similar definition, which says, if you want to judge whether a set is convex or not, pick two arbitrary points which are contained in the set, connect these two points with a line segment, and see if the line segment is completely contained in the set. If it is, the set is convex. If you are able to find two points, which when connected by a line segment, the line leaves the set, then the set is non-convex. Okay? So now tell me, which of these is convex set and which of them is not? So the one on the left, yeah.
The left one is convex.
Why?
Because we can't find two points that the line connecting these two points wouldn't be in the control.
Exactly right. Though I would make a small clarification. Line in English means priamka in Slovak. Okay? So here we are talking about line segments, so úsečka. Okay? So just to be straight. While here, why is this set non-convex? Because we have found at least two points for which the line segment leaves the set. Okay? So very similar to the definition of a convex set. Bottom line being is, if your constraints create such a set, and on your exercises you were already plotting these kind of constraint sets, if my information is correct. Okay, so if you see a shape like this, and if you cannot imagine a line or line segment leaving the set, then the constraint is convex. Bottom line, these constraints lead to convex optimization problems. These kind of constraints lead to non-convex optimization problems. These are simple to solve. This would take enormous amount of time and computational resources. In other words, this implementation is cheap. Implementation of such an optimization problem with these kind of constraints is expensive. In control, you are always looking also for the if not the least expensive implementation, then at least for a cheap implementation. So you want to avoid having constraints of this form. Okay? By the way, just as an anecdote, I will draw one figure and I will ask you whether the set is convex or not. And just imagine for a second that I have drawn a perfect circle. Okay? Now tell me, is this set convex or not?
Well, it depends if we are talking also about the...
Right. The interior. Okay, so essentially I can draw two versions of this, right? So one would be just the circle, meaning just the outside shape, and the other one would be also everything in between. Okay. Is this set convex? It is, right? You cannot find two points which, when connected by a line segment, the line segment leaves the set. Is this set convex? This set describes only the points on the perimeter, right? Now pick arbitrary two points, okay? Connect them. This is not part of the set because the set is only the outside perimeter, okay? But, okay, you didn't fall for this. Great. Okay. Now, unlike convex functions where you can deliver a rigorous mathematical proof that a function is convex or not, judging convexity of sets is much more difficult, in the sense, if you give me the formal mathematical definition of the set, it's actually very difficult to say whether the set is convex or not. However, there are some sets for which you can claim that are convex sets. And then if you see that your constraints is just a composition of these basic primitive sets, then you can also say something about the composition, about the overall composition of your constraints. And one of the basic sets which are guaranteed convex are so-called affine sets. On this kind of figure, essentially an affine set is essentially a line. Okay, and this time it really is a line, okay, so it's really a Priyamka. Whenever you see that your constraints can be written in this form, then you can claim that your constraints is convex. Now, there are two important factors to mention here. Each affine set is described by a so-called normal vector, and it is also defined by a displacement on the y-axis. Essentially, if I were to tell you, draw me a particular line, how would you draw it? What kind of information would you need to draw a line? Right? So you know the joke from a physics exam. Like the professor asked the student, like, run over the table. What does he do? He does nothing. And he asks, like, for which direction I should run. Because a speed is a vector and it has to have a direction. Okay? Of course, he also needs to know how quickly he should run, but a student who just starts running in an arbitrary direction would fail the exam. Okay? Because he didn't get the required information. And the same here. You cannot just start drawing lines because you need to know the tilt of the line. Okay? The tilt of the line, if we are in two dimensions, that's essentially the angle of the line. Okay? In general, this direction is defined by the normal vector, which is a vector which is perpendicular to the affine set. So it would be, in our case, for instance, this vector. If you know this vector, and if you know that the normal vector is always perpendicular, call me, to your affine set, then if I know this vector, I immediately know what is the angle of this affine set. And this normal vector is encoded in this vector B. Okay? And then we, of course, need to know the displacement. because there are actually infinite number of lines which have the same angle. Okay, just start pushing this line down. It still has the same angle, it still has the same normal vector, but it is a different line because the displacement is different. And this displacement is encoded in this scalar D. Okay? So that's what an affine set is about. It is a set of all points which lie on this line here. And this line in higher dimensions, it can be a plane. So just imagine a table, an infinite sized table. It's all points which lie on a straight surface. That's essentially what an affine set is. Okay? Another type of convex sets, which are very similar to affine sets, are so-called hyperplanes and half spaces. Essentially, hyperplanes and affine sets are, in weak terms, the same thing. A hyperplane, it's hyperplane. Hyper means that it can be in arbitrary dimensions. So usually hear this term in movies when they are jumping through the, passing the speed of light and these kind of things, okay? Hyperspeed and stuff like that. In mathematics, whenever you hear the adjective hyper, it just means it's in higher dimensions. So essentially in 2D, we have just a plane, and you all know what a plane is, okay? It's, again, a straight surface, and it's all points on this straight surface. Each straight surface is again determined by the normal vector plus some displacement. Half spaces, on the other hand, would be half space. Okay? This hyperplane, this line, essentially divides this whiteboard into two parts. One part which is on this side and the other part which is on this side. A half space is mathematically written in these terms, and it says it's all points which are either on the line, because here we have the equal, okay? So for a hyperplane, it's all points which satisfy this equation. It's only the points on this line. However, for a half space, it's either the points on this line or the points for which this inequality holds with a strict sign. So it's all points here. And again, each half space is determined by the normal vector plus some displacement. Bottom line being, if your constraints are in this form, no matter how many of these half spaces you have, you can claim that your overall constraints are convex. And this kind of hyper or half space type of constraints is very natural in practice. Whenever you want to say that my temperature has to stay between 20 and 100 degrees, right? That's exactly this type of constraint, because you are essentially saying T should be smaller than 100 and T should be larger than 20. And whenever you have larger than, you just multiply everything by minus 1 and you convert the sign to less equal. The mathematical convention is that you should convert all constraints into some quantity being smaller or equal to some constant. Okay? And we will use this convention later on. So, affine sets, hyperplanes, and half spaces are all convex sets. How do I know that the half space is a convex set? Can you find me two points, connect them by a line segment, and the line segment leaves the half space? No, you can't. Okay? Of course, if the half space would be like, ooh, like this, then it would be non-convex. But then it would not be a half space. It would not be a linear half space. By the way, does everybody know what this product here means and how is it computed? This is a so-called scalar product of two vectors. First of all, in mathematics, all vectors are by definition column vectors. Okay? Everybody knows what the T means here. Jana, what does a T mean? Transpose of a vector, exactly. So it turns a column vector into a row vector. And then if we have two vectors, the vector A has components A1, A2, A3. The X vector with components X1, X2, X3. What is A transpose times X?
A1,
X1.
Plus
A2, X2, plus A3, X3. So this is what this product means. What is important to realize here is that this is linear expression in X. Okay? So X are usually our decision variables, the unknowns. A is known. That's the direction of the Hall space. Hence, this is a linear expression in X. So you can imagine like A's be here be constants. Then you have no multiplication between the X's. If you, in your constraints, would have something like x1 times x2, this is a non-convex constraint, in general. So these are the typical examples of sets which are by definition convex. And the same. This is the most typical composition of these individual elements into overall constraints. If you start combining various Hall spaces, then you will end up with a geometric object, which is referred to as a polytope. A polytope has a very weird Slovak translation, which I never use personally. It's called mnohosten. And that's exactly what it means. It has many faces. It has many walls, which are essentially limiting the points which belong to such a polytope. Okay? So a polytope is a geometric object whose boundaries are straight lines. Okay? But be careful. You can only talk about boundaries being lines if we are in two dimensions. If we are in a three-dimensional object, like a table, okay? So this is a wall or a boundary of a table. It is not a line. It is the whole plane, I would say. Okay, so not just a line. But essentially, simply speaking, in two dimensions, a polytope is a geometric object which is delimited by straight lines. And it's essentially the intersection of various Hall spaces. Because you can just imagine that this Hall space, which points does it cover? Which points belong to a Hall space which points in this direction? It's all these points, right? For this Hall space, it's all these points here. Okay? But you see that if you now start adding the Hall spaces, they kind of cut out the space of the whiteboard, and what remains inside is the polytope. So the polytope is the set of points which satisfy each of these Hall spaces. So this point belongs to the polytope because it belongs to this Hall space, belongs to this Hall space, to this one, and to that one as well. Okay? This point does not belong to the polytope, even though it belongs to this Hall space. It belongs to this Hall space, to this one, and to this one. But it lives on a wrong side of this Hall space. This Hall space points in this direction. Okay? Now, it all depends on what are the normal vectors of individual Hall spaces. Of course, if now you would draw the line the opposite direction, so now just imagine, and since I cannot draw on that board, I will do it here. Okay? So we have roughly a shape like this. Okay? We have 5 Hall spaces. This is Hall space, the first one. This is its normal vector. The direction of the normal vector is very important because it tells you which points belong to the Hall space. And it's all the points which are on the opposite side of the normal vector. So if the normal vector points in this direction, the Hall space contains all the points on the opposite side. Okay? So what would be the normal vector for this Hall space if I want then to create this polytope? Should it point in this way or in that way? It should point downwards. Okay? Similarly, for this one, we have this normal vector, and for this one, this. Remember, a normal vector is always perpendicular to the half space. Meaning, if I have this as a normal vector, here this has to be a 90 degrees angle. Okay? For this one, again, this has to be a 90 degrees angle. That's what a normal vector is. Okay? If I now take the intersection of all these half spaces, and here, I would end up with this polytope. Now, what would happen if I would switch the sign of this half space and I would say, and this is very bad drawing, so we have this half space, and let me say its normal vector is here. Now tell me, what are the points which satisfy all half spaces? Give me one point which lives in all half spaces. It would be all points here, right? All of these points lie on this half space and simultaneously satisfy the constraints of the other half spaces. Okay? But what about this point here? Does it satisfy all constraints? Remember, this constraint says the point has to be on this side. Is it there? It is, right? This constraint says it has to be here. It is, right? But this constraint says the point has to be on this side. And it is not. Okay? So this is how you can essentially judge or draw such a polytope. Essentially, you are drawing these individual half spaces, and you start with the first one, and you know that these points do not belong in the set. So you just cut them off. You add a new half space and you end up, so let me do that. So I add the second half space and I end up with this set. So it's all the points, now it depends on the direction of the normal vector, say it's pointing this way. So which set of points satisfy both constraints? It's this set, right? Okay, so it's all these points. Okay, and then if I add a third half space, say with such a normal vector, it would be these points here. If I add a fourth one with such a normal vector, it would be then the set which is inside. Okay, so whenever you see a set of constraints where each line is essentially one half space, and half space is always of the form A transpose X as less than equal B, then you can claim that your constraints are a convex set, and therefore your optimization problem is going to be simple. Okay? Just one technical issue. If we have such a set, now, is this set a convex set? So it's all the points here in this cone. Okay? Is it a convex set? Why? Now I expect two different answers. So what would be answer number one? Why is this set convex?
Because if I choose two points,
yeah.
I cannot find the
exactly. So you use the argumentation with the line segment, okay? But there is another explanation why this set is convex. And that's because it is an intersection of two half spaces. Each half space is by definition a convex set, and the intersection of them is again by definition a convex set. Okay? So you even don't have to look at the figure. All you need to know is that this set is described as a set of points which simultaneously have to meet these two inequality constraints. First, what you see is that this is linear in X, and this is just a constant. In other words, this is a half space, this is a half space. This is all you need to know to proclaim your set to be a convex set, because it's an intersection of convex sets. And you don't need to draw the shape, okay? So we know it's a convex set, but now I want to make a distinction between this guy and what's drawn here. I said that in loose terms, a polytope is a geometric object whose boundaries are Hall spaces in 2D straight lines. Does this object meet that definition? No. Are its boundaries straight lines?
No, because it's unbounded from the top.
Does it make any difference regarding that definition? Does it invalidate the statement that the boundaries of this set are straight lines?
No.
Okay, so the boundaries are still straight lines here, right?
Yeah.
So the difference between this set and that set is that this set is so-called unbounded, meaning you take a point, or better to say, a half line, and you can go with the half line to the infinity, and it still belongs to the set. Okay? While here you take the half line, you try to go to infinity, and you are being stopped here. And now take arbitrary half line, and you will find that this set you can never leave while going to infinity. This is a so-called bounded set, and this is a so-called unbounded set. A geometric object, which is described as an intersection of a finite number of half spaces, in general is called a polyhedron. That's what Mnohostian means. And if that polyhedron is bounded, it is called a polytope. So every polytope is a polyhedron, but not every polyhedron is a polytope. What is this? This is a polyhedron. Every convex set given in this form is a polyhedron, and if moreover you can show that it's bounded, then we call it a polytope. So a polytope is essentially a subset of a polyhedron. Okay? Right. Here we see a couple of examples. Okay? So how do you think would the polytope given by these inequalities look like? Well, first of all, how many half spaces define such an object for which I proclaim it's a polytope? 4, right? So we have 4 inequalities. Are all these inequalities linear in X? They are. Hence, you can immediately claim what? Which property? Is it a polyhedron or is it a polytope? It is a polyhedron. You cannot say anything more. Only if you can then furthermore show that it is also bounded, then you can say it's a polytope. Now, I'm claiming here it's a polytope. Okay. So how would you draw a geometric object which is delimited by these inequalities? Okay, so it's in 2D, so it's relatively easy. And you already know how to do it in YALMIB, but now we just need to do it by hand. Okay? So we have the x1, x2 axis. Okay? What do the first two constraints say? Where has to be x1 and where has to be x2? So this, let it be -1, this would be +1, this would be 2. Okay? And for x2, here this is -1, this would be -1.5, and let it be 3. Okay? How does now the set look like? Well, the first constraint, all x1s which are larger than -1. Now I'm interested in how does the corresponding half space look like and what is its normal vector? Well, first of all, if it should be x1 bigger than -1, it must be all points here. Okay? So the half space has to run through here. Okay? And it has to be all these points. How would you draw the normal vector to this half space? It would be here, for instance. Okay? There are an infinite number of normal vectors, because a normal vector, it can have different sizes, right? What I said was not entirely correct. A normal vector is defined as a vector of length 1, Okay? But any vector of arbitrary size which points in this direction would do the job as well. Okay? So we have the first half space, the second half space. X1 is smaller than 2. So it would be this half space. Which direction does the normal vector point to? It goes here. Hence, the half space, or it's all the points on this side of the half space which satisfy the constraints. Okay? Now add the third constraint. X2 larger than minus 1.5. So we would have, okay, that here. Normal vector, up or down?
Down.
Hence, it's all points on the opposite side. If I would stay here, which set did we obtain? Which set of points satisfies simultaneously all three constraints? Would be all this here. Is this set bounded? No, because you can go to infinity and still be contained in the set. How would such a set be called? It would be a polyhedron. Okay? But fortunately, we have also this constraint which says x2 smaller than 3, normal vector in this direction, it's these two points. Hence, our set is essentially this box. Okay? It is bounded, first of all. And second of all, this set is given as an intersection of a finite number of half spaces. Therefore, it is a polyhedron. It is bounded, hence it is a polytope. Okay? Every bounded polyhedron is called a polytope. And these kind of convex sets arise very naturally in practice because you usually have constraints on your variables. Say you have temperature, concentration, pressure, whatever. Okay? You usually have limits, say temperature is between the lower and upper bound and so on. So every set which can be written in this form here is a convex set, which is important to us. And just one little detail is, we know that each of these constraints here can be written compactly in the form of ATX less than B. Okay? And for each half space, we can write it like this. So this would be for the first one, this would be for the second one, and so on. Then what we do fairly often is that we concatenate the normal vectors of individual half spaces into the matrix A, and we concatenate all these scalars B into a vector capital B. And then we just use this formal definition of a polyhedron in general. So a polyhedron P is a set. Whenever you see curly brackets, it means set. Okay? It's a set of points, X, which live in the n-dimensional Euclidean space. So here, we are living in a three-dimensional world. Okay? So n would be equal to 3. But in practice, if you are controlling a system which has 80 state variables, the dimension of your space would be 80. It's just much more difficult to imagine drawing in an 80-dimensional space. So P is a set of points in an n-dimensional Euclidean space which satisfy, that's this pipe, it means it's set of points that satisfy certain constraints, and the constraints are written compactly in this form. Essentially, this means that a particular point has to satisfy all of these constraints. So hence the polytope is the intersection of a finite number of Hall spaces. Now, this finite number is rather important because a circle can also be viewed as an intersection of Hall spaces, just infinitely many Hall spaces. Okay? So just start adding like Hall spaces, and if you can divide the space fine enough, then you can you will end up with the circle. Okay? But here we have a finite number of Hall spaces. And as I said, this is the most typical convex constraint used in model predictive control. In this class, we will exclusively work with this type of constraints for two reasons. First reason, it's a convex constraint. Second reason is the constraint can be essentially split into a series of linear constraints. And linear constraint is always the simplest constraint you can think of. Okay? So we have already seen that for an optimization problem to be convex, we require the objective function to be a convex function, and we require the constraints to create a convex set. However, there are many types of convex optimization problems. Some of them are extremely easy to solve, and some of them are quite difficult to solve. So even though they are convex, it is still not a guarantee that it will be easy to implement. Okay? There are, though, two categories of convex optimization problems which are extremely easy for implementation, meaning you can find the optimum very quickly. The first type is called linear programming or linear optimization problem, and the second one is quadratic programming or quadratic optimization problem. I bet you have already heard these two names, right? Okay. What is a linear program? Linear program is a special type of a convex optimization problem which has to satisfy two criteria. The first criterion is that the objective function is a linear function of our decision variables. So C is just a constant vector and X are the decision variables. Essentially, the C is again a normal vector of some hyperplane. Now, what is the difference between a hyperplane and a half space? Here, if you take this as a hyperplane, now tell me, is this point on the hyperplane? No. Is this point contained in the hyperplane? No. That's the difference between hyperplane and a half space. Okay? So if this would be a half space, then yes, because here this is the normal vector, half space contains all points on the opposite side, but that's a half space. A hyperplane is really just the points on this plane itself. But the plane, again, must have a normal vector, or otherwise you don't know how to draw it, okay? So just don't be misled by the fact that we have a normal vector, okay? So we have a hyperplane, it's all points on this plane. And C is simply the normal vector of this plane. Essentially, what we are doing in linear programming is we are trying to find the values of the vector X. X is the vector of decision variables. We want to find the values of X which minimize this linear function. Simple example, and I will have it also on the slides. Just imagine your company is producing two types of products. For the first one, you need 10 hours of whatever. It can be work, it can be the price of energy needed to create that product. And you want to find what is the optimal portfolio which you are going to produce. In the sense, I want to maximize my profit while minimizing my energy and other consumption. If you can express this as a linear function saying to produce one unit of product A, I spend €2, and to create one unit of product B, I spend €10, then you are asking yourself how many of products A and B should I produce to minimize my energy consumption. Okay? That's a linear function of the variables x1 and x2. However, we fairly often, and otherwise the whole optimization task wouldn't have any meaning, we always have constraints. Here, the constraints say what are your admissible decisions which you can take. Like, you always know that you are going to produce a non-negative amount of products. Okay? You must tell the optimization to avoid negative amount of products because otherwise it would tell you just produce minus 10 products and somehow it would mean that you are not consuming electricity but you are generating electricity. Okay? So the constraints say what are the admissible decisions. And if you have an optimization problem where the objective function is linear and the constraints are essentially either a polyhedron or a polytope, then we are talking about a linear optimization problem. In this particular setup, this is the polytope described by these inequalities here. We have an optimization direction which points in this way. And essentially, we are trying to push this line into this direction as much as possible as to minimize the objective function. And we end up in this point. Now, why didn't we end up here? Because this point wouldn't satisfy the constraints of the polytope, okay? So every optimal point has to satisfy the constraints in the first place. Otherwise, it cannot be optimal. So that's what a linear programming problem is. Linear objective function subject to linear constraints. Now, this is a small problem. What would happen in such a case? What did I do? I've just changed the normal vector of the optimization objective. Okay, so instead of minimizing in this direction, I am now minimizing in this direction, okay? And I'm claiming that this is the optimal point, optimal value of x. Now, what do you think about my reasoning? Can you find a point which is equally good as the red dot? Where would the point be, Dalibor? So all points on this line segment are equally good. They have the equal value of this objective function. And this is called a degenerate case, which happens if your optimization objective coincides with the half space like this. Okay? In that case, you have how many optimal points do you have? Can you count them? Yeah. Do you know how many push-ups did Chuck Norris do? All of them. Yeah, so we have an infinite number of points. Now, this is often a practical problem. Just imagine, well, you don't have to imagine. All optimization problems in the world are solved by a software. And the worst case which can happen in these situations is that sometimes the solver, the software which solves the problem, gives you as optimal this point, and 2 days later it claims this point is the optimal. 1 day later it claims this is the optimal point. I mean, all of these points are essentially equal from performance point of view. But now just imagine that this optimization is used for control. What it means is that, and furthermore, imagine that this point means the valve should be fully closed, and this means valve should be fully open. In other words, all possibilities between 0 and 1 are equally good. The worst thing you can expect from your controller, which is based on optimization, is that it starts so-called chattering. That it will say, close the valve because that's optimal. And in the next time, instead, it says, you know what, open it because it's still optimal, okay? And now just imagine what happens to the equipment, okay? Rapidly changing the control inputs is not very good for the physical device, okay? So that's one of the dangers of linear optimization that you have to consider when using it for control, that these kind of situations can happen. In general, in linear optimization, the optimal solution is always on a vertex. So just imagine this is a polytope. The polytope has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 vertices. In linear programming, the optimal solution is always on a vertex. Even here, if it is not on a vertex, there exists a vertex which is equally good. So here, there is always two vertices which have the same value of objective function as this point here. Okay? That's a feature of linear programming. the least efficient way how to solve these optimization problems is to find all vertices and then simply evaluate this objective function at all vertices and simply take the value which is minimal. Now the problem with that is you don't know the vertices because you only know the inequality constraints. Just think about this situation where we said x1 is bigger than minus 1.5 and so on. Give me the four vertices of such a polytope. Okay? In 2D it's trivial. So you draw it on a paper and then you say, ah, it's easy. The first vertex is minus 1.5 minus 1. Sorry, minus 1 is the first coordinate, minus 1.5 the second. What are the coordinates of this vertex?
2, 3.
Okay? However, now imagine that you are in 80-dimensional space and you have thousands of these constraints. Now tell me the vertices. Okay? It's not so easy anymore. That's one problem. The second problem is how many vertices, or how do you think the number of vertices scales with the dimension? What do I mean by that? Take a square. How many vertices does it have?
Four.
A square is an object in how many dimensions?
Two.
Now take a cube. What is the dimension of a cube?
Three.
What is the number of vertices of a cube? Eight. Can you see the relation? It's 2 to the power of dimension of the polytope. Now enter 80 as the exponent. Okay? That many vertices can a polytope in 80 dimensions have? It's close to the number of atoms in the whole universe. Okay? So the naive way of solving these kind of optimization problems would never work. Okay? Nevertheless, there are efficient algorithms which compute the optimum, even though the optimum always lies on a vertex. But they don't have to go through all possible vertices to find the optimum. Now, it is beyond this class on how these algorithms work. What is important for us is there is a piece of code to which you give vector C, matrix A, matrix B, and it will give you in no time the optimal solution. Okay? So these are linear optimization problems. A more advanced version of linear programming is called quadratic programming. And again, there are two features which, if they are satisfied, you can claim that this is a quadratic optimization problem. First of all, the objective function has to be a quadratic function. And second of all, and this is very important, and always remember this, even though the name is quadratic programming, the constraints have to be linear. Because you fairly often see a constraint which is quadratic. But such a problem is not a quadratic optimization problem. Can you name me a quadratic constraint? At least one example of a quadratic constraint. Say in two dimensions. And explain to me why that is a constraint which can occur in practice. Okay. So the simplest I can think of is circle again, but also with the interior. How would we mathematically describe all points inside of this circle? Say the origin is the center here. But better to say this is a disk, okay? Just to make a distinction from a circle, which is just the outside shape. Okay? Yeah?
X squared.
Yeah, so I would do it this way, like x1 plus x2 squared
is
smaller than
radius.
Something like that. Radius is the whole thing. This would be half of the radius. or is it radius the polymer? Polymer. Yeah, it should be polymer. Yeah. Okay. So this is a quadratic constraint. Is this set convex? It is, right? What if I use this constraint here? Would it stay a quadratic optimization problem? No, because the constraints are not linear. So the term quadratic only applies to the objective function. Always keep this in mind. Because if you then think, I have a quadratic optimization problem and just add this little constraint, you destroy all the nice properties. Because this is an optimization problem which is still easy to solve. With this constraint, it would no longer be easy to solve. Okay? This is a quadratic function. This is a special type of a quadratic function in higher dimensions. Essentially, what we see here is level sets of this objective function. So in Slovak, it would be vrstevnice. Okay? So just imagine you have a quadratic function. You all know how a quadratic function looks like, right? In 2D, it's easy. This is a quadratic function. But if we are in two dimensions, then it's actually the whole thing. Okay? And what we are looking here is at slices of the objective function, and these are the level sets. And then we are looking for the optimal point. The optimal point is a point which, first of all, has to satisfy constraints, and second of all, has to be a point for which this objective function is minimized. Okay? And it's this point there. Now, remember what I said about these linear optimization problems. In linear programming, the optimal solution is always at the vertex. In quadratic optimization problem, this no longer has to hold. Here, this is the optimal point, but it is not a vertex of the polytope, right? And then, it just depends where you put the polytope. Because this can be the optimal point. Again, it is not a vertex, but it as well can be a vertex. Okay? So what I want to say by these slides here is, if you can formulate your MPC problem either as linear programming or a quadratic programming problem, you can very efficiently solve these problems in reality. So essentially, it would just take at maximum couple of seconds to obtain the optimal solution, even if your problem is very complex. While if the objective function would not be convex, or if you would use these type of constraints, then the solution can be easily in terms of hours. Okay? And that would really require still a powerful machine. So these are the two basic types of optimization problems. Now remember, for a linear programming problem, the objective function must be linear, and the constraints must be linear as well. Quadratic optimization problem means linear constraints and quadratic optimization objective. To make matters worse, and I really do apologize that I have to go through these kind of details, but if you then talk to people who are implementing mode operative control, they require you to know these kind of details. What I want to say is that in practice, there are two basic forms of linear programming, which essentially means that there are two types of softwares which solve these problems. One type of software allows you to define inequality constraints as well as equality constraints. Now, I didn't talk about the equality constraints before, but they are essentially in type of hyperplanes. Okay? So, first of all, what type of a geometric object is this? It's a set which satisfies these constraints. How do we call the set in general? Polyhedron. When is it a polytope? If it is bounded, okay? So this set will give me a polytope, say this one. This is a set of equality constraints, okay? Each of the G's can have multiple rows, like this. If I just take one of those constraints and I draw them like this, now tell me. Show me the points which are simultaneously in the polytope and simultaneously on the line. Which points are those? It is just this line segment, right? Okay. Now imagine I add another equality constraint. This one. Tell me all the points which are simultaneously in the polytope, meaning satisfy the inequality constraints, and simultaneously satisfy all equality constraints. Equality constraint really means it must be on the line. There is only one point there. Okay. What if I add a third line? Give me a point which satisfies all constraints simultaneously. There is no such point. Okay. So this is what equality constraints mean. It tells you, you can have a nice polytope, nice shape to look at, but from the whole polytope, it's only particular points. Okay. And so what I want to say is this is the most general formulation you can think of. It allows you to specify the polytope as well as the equality constraints. And there is software which solves problem defined in this form. And there is a second category of software tools which require this special formulation. How are these two formulations different from each other? Is there a difference in the objective function? No, it's still linear in X. There is no difference in the equality constraints. But this formulation doesn't allow you to enter a polytope and instead requires that the axes are non-negative. Okay. And unfortunately, this software is more common than a software which allows you to define this polytope. However, these two formulations are equivalent in the sense that you can go from one to the other and vice versa. And that's what I want to show you next. Why is it important? Because then if you will be working as an MPC engineer, it's one thing to formulate the optimization problem. And you say, I've gone through an MPC class, I know what is the difference between a polytope and a polyhedron. I formulate my optimization problem like this, because it's natural. And then your employer will tell you, but you have to use a software which solves these type of problems. You have to know how to transfer or how to transform this formulation into this form and vice versa. Otherwise, you would never know how to actually solve the problem in practice. Okay, so that's why it is important you go through these kind of details. Now, this conversion, it's a standard matter of all MPC courses all over the world. Fortunately, nowadays, we have automatic procedures which do that. So this would be the first and the last time I will even bother you with this kind of reformulation. But I rely on you that you will remember how to do that. And we will check that in the exam. Okay. Okay, so let's take a look on how to transform a problem defined in this form and put it here. Okay? There are two aspects which make the conversion non-trivial. The first one is we have to somehow get rid of these inequality constraints. Okay? Because there are only these type of inequality constraints there. Okay, so the A and B magically went away. That's the first problem. And the second problem is that here, X could have been arbitrary. Some of its components could even take negative values. While in this formulation, X has to be non-negative. So how to reformulate a negative value as a non-negative value? One thing I would like to clarify here. When I have C, A, B, G, H there, and I have the same symbols here, it does not mean that the entries are the same. In other words, during the conversion, we will see that the what was G here would become a different G in this formulation. So these are not the same G's as in the previous formulation. Okay. So let us take a look on how first to eliminate these inequality constraints. And remember, each of those inequality constraints describes in general a polyhedron. And let's just take a polytope because it just doesn't matter here in this case. Okay. The procedure says is the polytope is delimited by a finite number of linear constraints. And for each point which lives in the polytope, we know what is its distance from a particular half space which defines the polytope. Okay, so this would be the first half space, A1 transpose X less than equal B, and with this normal vector, okay, because it points in this direction. Okay, let us call the difference S1. So that's the distance of this point to the constraint. In other words, it's like asking, by how much should I shift this point in the direction of this normal vector such that I end up on the constraint? Okay? Now, if this would be a second half space, A2x less than equal B2, then this would be the distance S2 by which I should move this point in order to get it exactly on the half space. Okay? And it is a distance, so all of these S's, and we have as many, these are called slack variables, we have as many of these slack variables as there are constraints. So this would be S3, and this would be, now I have to draw it perpendicular, this would be S4, and here this would be S5. And we know that each of these slack variables, since they denote a distance, they must be non-negative. Okay? And if we rewrite these inequality constraints into this form, meaning here the only optimized variable was x. We wanted to find the elements of a vector x for which we achieve a minimal value of the objective function. Now, instead, well, on top of looking for an optimal x, we also look at what are the amount by which we should shift the optimal point in order to be on a half space, on a hyperplane. So by how much should I add here for the point to satisfy this constraint with equality? Okay? If we do that, two things will happen. First of all, we rewrite or we transform these inequality constraints into equalities. And for the translation, we had to introduce new variables Si, each of them being non-negative. And look here, what do we require? We require that all constraints are equalities and the variables are non-negative. So we are on the right way. Okay? Because we have achieved a linear constraint and we have achieved a non-negativity constraint. What remains to be done here is that somehow we have to work around the problem that the optimal vector x can have negative entries. But fortunately, or why is that a problem for this formulation? Here x can only take non-negative values. Okay? So we have to do something about the fact. Fortunately, what we can do is to rewrite an arbitrary number, a scalar or a vector, as a difference of two non-negative scalars or vectors. So just imagine x is minus 1. For sure, I can write it as a difference of 1 minus 2, right? 1 is non-negative, 2 is non-negative, okay? And you can verify at home that indeed you can rewrite an arbitrary number as a difference of two non-negative numbers. We do that by introducing new variables. One would be called x plus, and the other one x minus. And then we simply use this substitution, meaning wherever we had x before, we will insert x plus minus x minus. What will happen then is that we arrive at this formulation. So again, what I have done? Two things. First, we have eliminated these inequalities by introducing slack variables. These slack variables have to be non-negative. And here I'm just using a compact notation. So S here is a vector. Okay? So the S would be a vector, in this particular case, composed of components S1 to S5. These are the slack variables which I have to add to the constraint to reach equality. Okay? That was the first thing. And the second thing is that I had to replace negative numbers as a difference of two non-negative numbers. So introducing the vectors x plus and x minus. And then whenever I had x here, I just put x plus minus x minus. Okay? The same here, because there was an x there. So again, a difference x plus minus x minus. There was an x here, so we had to substitute the difference there as well. Why are we doing that? Because in this formulation, all decision variables have to be non-negative. And that's exactly the case with our setup. X plus must be non-negative, x minus must be non-negative, and the slacks must be non-negative as well. Okay? Now, is this formulation the same as this one? In other words, if you formulate the problem in this way, can you solve it with this solver? Is it in the same form? Why not? Well, your answer may be that here this assumes that the decision variable will be called x, and here the decision variables are called x plus, x minus, and s. Okay? But we know that's not really a major obstacle. What we do here is, let us concatenate all decision variables, meaning vectors x plus, x minus, and s, into a new decision vector, and let us call the vector z. Okay? X plus is a vector, x minus is a vector, s is a vector. All vectors, by definition, are column vectors. So let us stack them below each other. And we obtain a new vector z. Okay? Now, if I know that the vector z is of this form, how do I design a matrix C tilde such that C transpose z is equal to what we have here? Is equal to C transpose x plus minus C transpose x minus. How should C tilde look like when z is x plus, x minus, and s? How many components would C tilde have? 3, right? What would be the first component? That's the component which multiplies x plus, and it must give you this result. C is not exactly the correct answer. C transposed. What would be the second component? Minus C transposed. What is the third component? How would you write this, say, in MATLAB? Would you just type 0? No, you can't, because S is a vector. Okay? So it must be a 0 vector. Right? And then if you multiply this C tilde with the vector Z, you would get exactly this form. Okay? So what we are doing here is essentially we are coming at a compact representation of the optimization problem. And the same concatenation we then do for these two equality constraints. To write them in a compact form, we simply create compact representation of the matrices. Okay? So the first one, the first constraint would have some elements. This would be multiplied by x plus, x minus, and s. And it must give the right-hand side. The right-hand side of these two equality constraints are just b and h. So b and h. So we have two set of equations. We have one, two, three components in the first line, three components in the second line. This component times this plus this times this plus this times this must be equal to b. So we come here and we ask ourselves, what is the multiplier of x plus in the first constraint? It's a, right? What is the multiplier of x minus in the first constraint? It's minus a. Now it comes interesting. What is the multiplier of a vector s in the first constraint? Zero. Remember, what we are trying to achieve is a compact form which is equivalent to what we see here. So what is the multiplier of a vector s in the first equation?
I
mean what? How would you define an I? What is it?
One vector?
Not exactly. It has to be a matrix. Yeah, so it's called the identity matrix. Okay? So a matrix just with the ones on the main diagonal and zeros everywhere else. Okay, what are the multipliers for the second constraint? What is here? What does multiply x plus in the second constraint?
G.
G for x minus? Minus G for s?
Zero.
What can you say about the dimension of this zero? Is it a scalar zero or a vector zero or a matrix zero? It would be a matrix zero. Okay. And then what we do is very simple. We call this a G tilde, and we call this an H tilde. And we can equivalently represent this problem in this compact form, where the new decision vector is Z. Now, can I solve this problem using this solver? Yes, because it's exactly in the same form. Okay? It's just a bunch of equality constraints plus non-negativity constraints on the optimization variables. Okay? So this is how you translate your optimization problem into this form in order to use this special solver or piece of software. Okay? As I said, luckily nowadays you can, or you mostly don't have to do it manually. It is usually done automatically by some other software layer. Okay? Okay, just before we finish, the opposite direction. That's actually very easy. Okay, I don't want to bother you with details because the experts know that it's actually not that easy. But there is a trivial way, and usually if you see a trivial way, it's not really very efficient. But if you were to tell me this explanation on an exam, I would not object too much. Okay? So first of all, what is the difference between these two formulations if I want to go from this to that one? Do I need to change the objective function? Do I need to change the equality constraints? Do I need to change the equality constraints? Actually, you will find, if you carefully look here, that it already is in that form. The only difference being that here we assume less equal and here we have greater equal, okay? So let us multiply these constraints by minus 1. Since x is a vector, that minus 1 has to be a minus identity matrix. By multiplying it with a negative matrix, we actually reverse this sign, and we end up with this formulation. Okay? Now, is it the same as there? In other words, what is A and what is B? Because we already have G and H here. What is A? What is B?
B is
a zero matrix. So all the right-hand sides of the constraints are always vectors, never matrices. Okay? So this would be a zero vector. And A is simply minus the identity matrix. And you have converted problem defined in this form such that it is suitable for this solver. Such that you know what does it mean to solve a problem using a software. Essentially, you need to provide the values of A, B, G, H, and C. That's what the solver expects of you. So you have to know which values to enter there. Only then you can solve the problem. And simultaneously here, you need just to tell the software what is C, G, and H. Okay? And you know you need to know how to come up with the entries of the matrices. Okay? So I spend unexpectedly a lot of time on these details. As I said, they are important for you to understand what is a convex optimization problem, because you, in general, we can only solve convex optimization problems quickly enough. Therefore, we always want to have a convex optimization problem at the end. What is important for you is to realize, does my control design procedure lead to a convex optimization problem or not? Now, for the objective function, it's rather easy. If your objective function only contains norms, you are safe, because a norm is a convex function. And we will see later that norms are almost exclusively used in MPC cost functions. So we have a convex objective function, but we also need convex constraints. And we have seen that as long as your constraints are polyhedral, meaning they are, the singular is polyhedron, and if you have many of them, it's polyhedra. Okay? And polyhedral, it's an adjective. So, a pre-down manner. So, if the constraints can be written as linear inequalities, you know you have a convex optimization problem. Okay? So, that's why I really had to go through these details, such that in the future, you can just look at the mathematical formulation and immediately convince somebody that yes, this is a convex optimization problem, or no, this is not a convex optimization problem, and if it is not, why it is not. Okay? Usually it is not a convex optimization problem if you see nonlinear constraints. Okay? Multiplication, powers, square roots, logarithms, nasty things. Okay? Linear is fine, everything else is not as good. Okay? So in the future, we will be able to tell whether you have a convex problem. And you know, in the future, you will know how to formulate your MPC problem as to end up with easily solvable optimization, which usually means you want to end up as a quadratic optimization problem or as a linear optimization problem. So that would be Paul. Yeah, we will see it later. Are there any questions? If not, then I would like to thank you for your attention, and we'll be looking forward for the next lecture.